now come to today's special program, celebrating the very, very important anniversary, the 15th anniversary of the admission of women to our club. Some call it the city club's finest moment. Others said it showed how far behind the times we were. Regardless of how you feel looking back to October 1973, the fact is that 41% of our members are women. Women have assumed every club leadership role, and the club would not have survived in anything like its present form without that important decision. Today, several people will share their experiences and perspectives on that time. The head table with me is Don Sterling, who was president of the club at the time of the final vote to admit women. Don's, of course, assistant to the publisher of the Oregonian at the time of the vote, was editor of the Oregon Journal, which covered this controversy for several years. Don will discuss the context within which the decision to admit women was made. After Don speaks, Multnomah County Commissioner Gretchen Kafoury, who is seated at Don's left, will speak. Gretchen was an organizer of POW, Politically Oriented Women, which was dedicated to, the word here is pressuring the city club, perhaps convincing the city club into admitting women. Using techniques familiar to the civil rights movement, POW's efforts, of course, finally succeeded. Gretchen will talk about what it was like to engage in that campaign, but first, welcome to Don Sterling.
The good old days. Some of you may have seen the picket line out in front, the symbolic picket line today. 15 years ago this week, there was a picket line out there for real of the women who, mostly women, some men, were in the picket line, campaigning again for the admission of women to the city club. On that day, I actually found my own name on one of those picket signs, which probably adds a corollary to Andy Warhol's line about everybody these days is going to be famous for 15 minutes. Everybody once maybe gets his name on a picket sign. Well, the upshot of the meeting that we attended here 15 years ago in this very room was that women on the fourth vote, were admitted to membership in the City Club by a margin of 7 votes. The campaign to bring that about lasted for 3.5 years, extended through the presidencies of 5 men, and through there weren't any other available at the time. And through the overlapping tenures of 4 boards. It was sometimes a bitter controversy. There were touches of humor to it. There was obviously an underlying serious purpose to it. It was probably without question the most divisive and long-lasted controversy that the City Club has engaged in its entire history. I should say, to set this in context, there certainly was no time during those 3.5 years, at every time in that 3.5 years, there was a majority of the board of the club in favor of admitting women. By all the evidence, there was a majority in the membership for that entire period in favor of admitting women. But for reasons that I'm going to go into, it was a long process. It began in 1969, and interestingly, it began not in Portland, but in Gresham. It began among men and not women. It began with some conversations among 3 members of the City Club who had, at least 2 of them, had Gresham roots. Doug Myers, who was the manager of the Gresham branch of the United States National Bank, Laird Kirkpatrick, who then was an attorney, who now is a law professor at the University of Oregon and spoke on this platform last month on the governor's corrections package. And Dr. George Casterline, who is a doctor with practice out at 12 Mile Corner near Gresham, asked themselves, why don't we have women in the City Club? They gathered they thought they needed more support. They added 3 more men to their group. Dr. Earl Klapstein, who was then president of Mount Hood Community College, Sidney Lezak, who was United States Attorney for Oregon, and Dr. Paul Wright, who was a past president of the City Club and the Presbyterian minister at the First Presbyterian Church. Those six men submitted a letter to the Board of Governors in May of 1970. I have not seen the letter, but in effect it asked to have the women admitted to the club. The board changes, you know, and at the end of May, 1st of June, and the incoming board was headed by Dr. Herbert Goodman, a dentist. That board immediately took up the question and began to look at what the problem was. And there was controversy on the board as to whether they themselves could act. They decided they could not. They decided that the situation, formally speaking, the problem was a little three-letter word in the club constitution, M-E-N. The club constitution then said, the purposes of this organization shall be to provide a common meeting ground for congenial, forward-looking men of divergent beliefs, politics, and occupations. And the board, Ogden Beeman was then a member of that board, later became a president of the club. He suggested a Gordian knot solution of simply interpreting men to mean mankind. And they seriously considered that. But it didn't fly. And one of the other big obstacle was an even more powerful force, as anyone who knows this club knows, and that was club tradition. In all of its 54 years at that time, the club had never had a woman member. In fact, at that time, women were not allowed to attend its meetings, except on special occasions and with an important exception that I'm going to get to. I have a friend, Barbara Farrow Walker, who figured out, in those days the city club met usually in the Crystal Room downstairs. Crystal Room has a little balcony at one end. Barbara discovered that there's a way to get through the manager's office up here on the second floor and crawl through a little door. And she used to make a practice of sneaking out there like a crouching Juliet to watch the meetings of the city club. The board took care of that in pretty short order. By November of 1970, they changed the rules so that women could attend the club as guests. But they then determined that this was a constitutional issue. It was a question of amending the club constitution to say that it is a club not for congenial forward-looking men, but congenial forward-looking individuals or people. And in all of the four votes, that was the issue, the amendment of the Constitution substituting one word for the other. Then they ran into some other procedural problems. The club constitution can, and this is still true today, can only be amended by a two-thirds vote at a meeting, such as we're having today. It can't be done by proxy. It can't be done by mail. So there was no way of determining the desires of the entire club. Could only be done by those people who chose to attend a meeting, and it had to be done by a two-thirds vote. That was the hang-up. There was always, probably always a majority, but it was awfully hard to get the two-thirds. The matter came to a vote first in January 8th of 1971, and it carried by one vote, yes, but one wasn't enough. It took two-thirds. It was 47 short of the required majority. I will give you some of the arguments pro and con that were presented at that meeting. Essentially, they were the same arguments that prevailed from then on. These were some of the pro arguments. Somebody said, it ill behooves this club to keep this type of segregation, which affects not a minority, but the majority of this country's population. Another said, if this club is to be meaningful, it must include all members of the community. Someone said male chauvinism might be harmless if it didn't carry over into important things. And city club membership is regarded as prestigious, as we keep reminding ourselves. Another person said, if the question were to admit Jews or blacks, there's no doubt which way it would go. Well, interestingly enough, on the con side, one of the speakers was a black member of the club who said, ordinarily, I'd be for total integration, but I think we should have a private domain here where men can be men. Another argument against was, if you have, and I think this was probably the most powerful one, and by my judgment at that time, of the con, if you have a formula that succeeds, don't change it. And then there was the man who said, and I know who this man is, but I'm not going to give his name. I dread the thought of fighting for luncheon seating with housewives who can get here at 11:15. The only notable addition to that I choose to recall from later debates on the subject was the man at a later debate on this issue who urged the club not to introduce an additional cleavage into the club. It came to a vote for a second time in October of 1971 with a majority in favor of admitting women, but 55 short of the needed majority. It was voted again for the third time in July of 1972 and failed by 6 votes. Voted again in October 1973 and carried by 7. Now, I told you already that the boards were always a majority of the boards, not uniformly, but a majority of the boards were in favor of admitting women. But it then, after periodic resubmissions of this, it became a question of how often can you go to the well? How often can you ask club members to vote on something that by their votes they have decided, just as we've decided our positions today? Not everybody accepted that point of view, but it was a problem that I can tell you from service on the board was one the boards considered. After the first vote, as far as I know, was when women outside, who obviously were outside the club, became interested. And Gretchen Kafoury is going to speak to that point. Soon after that first rejection in January of 1971, a group that called itself Politically Oriented Women announced that they were going to try to do something about this. They wrote to speakers, potential speakers, urging them not to speak at the City Club. By June of 1972, they were out there picketing. They had certain all-purpose signs like shame and oink. And then they tried to, and I say this on the basis of what I've seen them quoted as saying, again, Gretchen can speak better than I, they would always try to have some sign that was relevant to the day. One of the early speakers under this program was Mary Calderon, who was a nationally known advocate of sex education, and their sign that day was, "The City Club needs sex education." This group also began urging members to resign in protest and to withhold their dues. And I will say on that point, and there is plenty of disagreement on this, but that also was one of the problems that the advocates of admitting women were dealing with. Because of the requirement of a two-thirds vote, one opponent outweighs or equals the weight of two proponents. So every time someone resigned, it became harder. Someone who felt that women should be admitted resigned, it became harder for those who stayed in and wanted women in to carry the day. The question was asked to these women, why were they picking on the City Club? There were plenty of clubs in Portland, and they still are some, that do not allow women to join. And the answer given was, well, the City Club is where the action is. Now, against the background to all this, you need to have in mind, this was a turbulent, fermenting period in American life. Civil rights demonstrations had prevailed in the 60s. The Vietnam War was dragging on and produced all kinds of demonstrations, picketings, even violence, bombings, and shootings. It's hard to remember, or it's pleasant not to remember the turbulence of that time in some ways. The Watergate scandal was unfolding. In the same week that the City Club voted finally to admit women, the United States House of Representatives voted to go ahead with its study of the impeachment of President Nixon. It was a time of political activism. A young man named Neil Goldschmidt was getting himself elected to the Portland City Council for the first time. Oregon was adopting the bottle bill and the beach bill. Lots of things were being done by means of political pressure and activism. Most to the point, it was the years of the birth of the women's movement. Not the birth, of course, but the flowering of it. The Congress in this period of 3 years finally sent out the Equal Rights Amendment to the states. And in this period, Oregon ratified the Equal Rights Amendment. Colleges like Princeton and Yale that had been all-male institutions admitted women for the first time. The FBI took in its first women agents. Clubs like the National Press Club and the Harvard Club of New York accepted women for the first time. Counterpart clubs to the City Club on the West Coast, the Town Hall in Los Angeles, and the Commonwealth Club in San Francisco admitted women just shortly before the City Club did. The counterpart club in Seattle, whose name eludes me, had always had women in its membership. All of these things, while I can't say that how they might have affected the City Club vote, certainly provided a background to it. The demonstrations and the dissension within the club did have its effect. The club still functioned. It met every Friday. It did its research. It took in new members. But there is no question that it was crippled in its activities, especially as the second and third years dragged on. Some speakers did refuse to speak at the City Club. Some members withheld their dues, and of course that had an effect on the budget. Some members refused to take assignments on committees, which is the lifeblood of this club. Three members of the board at one time or another resigned from the board because they wanted women in and the women hadn't gotten in yet. Kim McCall, Dr. Gerald Kogan, and Dr. Walter Reynolds. The membership dropped, in spite of, as I say, that new members were coming in, but more were going out by resignation and just surrender. Because some of the people who didn't want women in got tired of the argument and quit also. In June 1, 1971, the club was 1,623. By September 30th of 73, just before the final vote, it was down to 1,282. Club lost about 250 members net in that period. Another effect was that a lawsuit was filed against the City Club Foundation challenging its tax exemption on the grounds that it was discriminatory. The plaintiffs in that suit were the American Civil Liberties Union, of which we've been hearing something lately, and Gladys McCoy, now a county executive. The interesting thing was the club or the foundation were not defendants. The suit was brought in Washington, D.C. against the Treasury Department. One of the defendants was George Shultz, now Secretary of State. Perhaps there is someone here who knows how that was in the end resolved. The club and the foundation took the position that since they weren't defendants, they weren't going to do anything about it, and didn't. Although the foundation did consider amending its rules to make anyone who contributes a dollar a member of the foundation. That, if women had contributed, I presume was the idea was, would have eliminated the question of discrimination. But anyway, women were finally admitted. The suit, as far as I know, never had and never came to a head. There were two individuals who were especially affected. One was Sidney Lezak, who was president-elect in 1972, took office as president in the summer of 72, and said before he did that he would resign if he became convinced that there was no prospect of admitting women to the club. After the third vote, he became convinced, and he did resign as president, though not as a member of the club. The club then, without any controversy, unanimously elected John Bledsoe, who had been a previous president, I think in about 68 or 69, to serve another term. And that makes John, I think, he shares the distinction with Grover Cleveland. He's the only man who's ever served two non-consecutive terms as president. The other person affected was the big exception that I mentioned in the beginning, and that was the City Club's executive secretary of this time, LMAW Naylor, Woody Naylor. No one in the history of the City Club has had more to do with the success of the club and has been more loyal to its traditions than Woody Naylor. In this period, she had been secretary for almost 20 years, longer than anyone has ever been executive secretary of the City Club. This was a wearing job at the best of times, and this was not the best of times. Some of the attacks that were made on the club were made against Woody personally. And by the summer of 1973, she announced to the board that she was going to resign, and she did. And we had a going away ceremony for her here on this platform a week before the final vote. She's an honorary lifetime member of the club, and she deserves it. Then followed the vote. Women were admitted by a 7-vote margin, and the storm, like a summer thundershower, just went away. The first woman to apply for admission to the City Club was up at the City Club office having her picture taken for the newspaper 45 minutes after the vote. That was Mildred Schwab, then a city commissioner. In the first week, there was also one other woman admitted, Cornelia Frank. And as the bulletin has told you, a number of others followed very swiftly. And as there are two of them, Pauline Anderson and Arcelia Forbes, have since served as president of the club. There's an interesting thing about the statistic that Phil gave you as I started. Membership now is up to about 2,800, of whom 41% are women, and the percentage is rising. That means that the male membership of the club is about back to where it was before this controversy started, but it is no higher. The gain in the club, and there has been gains in many fields, but the gain in membership is attributable to the membership of women. Men have not joined in any greater degree than they did before the club was integrated. And if there's any significance of that, it's to be discussed another day.
Good afternoon. It's very exciting to be here. I have listened, and Don and I were discussing the impact that the City Club history has in the interweaving with the Board of County Commissioners. If you think about it, our chair, Gladys McCoy, was mentioned as a plaintiff in the ACLU lawsuit. Pauline Anderson was the first woman president of the club, one of my colleagues. Another is Polly Casterline, who couldn't be here today, but George, her husband, was one of the first two members of the club who asked to have women join. And of course, I had some small part in this integration effort as well. We were remembering the comments about the housewives. And of course, that it always stuck with us. But the irony in remembering and thinking of what I wanted to talk about today with you, we were housewives. And the group you see gathered taking the front tables today is, in fact, was at that time a group of housewives. We were parents, and most of our husbands were members of the club. And we had all worked either in the campaigns for city council of Neil Goldschmidt or of Tom Walsh, who had run against Frank Ivancy in 1970. And after those elections, we had formed quite a bond. We were, of course, unpaid workers at the time, but we were following our activism. We said, we're really great people. Why don't we get together? We would get together every couple of Wednesdays. And embarrassingly, we called ourselves the Wednesday Winos, because that was a prime focus of what we did on those Wednesdays. But with our children, we talked about marriages. We weren't getting divorced yet at that time. We talked about politics, and of course, we talked about the City Club and the upcoming vote to allow women, and most of our husbands came that day, and by golly, it was voted down. This was the very first vote in early 71. Looking back again, I'm surprised that we were so surprised that it didn't pass, but we were quite taken aback and immediately set about discussing in our activist way, what might we do about this? The first thing we did was obviously to change the name of the group. We couldn't be the Wednesday Winos and be taken seriously. So it now was an active group then in the Women's Political Caucus, so we, of course, settled on POW, Politically Oriented Women. It had a nice ring to it. We discussed what kinds of tactics we might employ, and Don has mentioned this was, after all, the early 70s. The logical tactic was picketing, and we began busily writing a number of letters to potential speakers to the club, asking them not to speak until this issue was resolved, and we began what we then called an informational picket. Early on, I have to say, at least my memory serves me, that we really had quite a sense of humor about this. I remember we had a dress code. And one member especially, who smoked pipes, if you recall, she was banned from smoking her pipe anywhere near the picket line. We had the pearl earring rule, if preferably you wore pearl earrings. Gloves were encouraged, but not mandatory. But we tried not to look too disgraceful and embarrass the people who were coming either through the side door, like some people who won't be mentioned, or just walking right through the picket line saying hello to us. One of our first, I think our first picket line was, in fact, Mary Calderon. And we had written to her. In fact, Betty Roberts wrote to her and explained the circumstances and said we were engaged in an effort not to have speakers until this issue was resolved. And she wrote back and said that she had never experienced discrimination, and so from henceforth, we have referred to her as Mrs. Frank Calderon. I can't leave today, though, without telling you that what we began with a lot of humor and probably a lot of innocence soon became very serious business for us. We were invited to speak to the Board of Governors. They had a public hearing to debate the issue, should women be admitted to the City Club? And as we prepared our testimony and decided which salient points we would bring up, it suddenly struck us that the club would not be holding this hearing were it a question of admitting blacks or admitting a religious minority. And we began to have quite sad feelings, I would say, about the nature of the discrimination. The debate, as you can tell, when the votes came up, ranged from painful to ridiculous. The cleavage effort, I think, is on the handout we gave you today just for fun. But people, having a black male stand up and say that women didn't really need to be here to integrate the club was a particularly painful time. At one point, just so you don't think I'm getting too serious today, when the media interest began to wane, and we were there almost every Friday, so it was getting kind of boring, and we decided that we would have send a press release and announce that there had been some incidents of pinching on the picket line. The other newspaper, not the one that Don was with, the Journal, which was supporting, not enthusiastically, but they were supporting our efforts, but the other newspaper picked this story right up, and I remember it ran on the front page, and it said, Director of Security Gretchen Kafoury protests pinching on the picket line. So we immediately, it was probably the most fun we had, we immediately garnered our wits, got the helmet and the rolling pin, and had the exciting day that you've seen where we really tried to get the media back. It was, that was right before the third vote, and the bulk of our energies had focused on the third City Club vote. I would say the 18-month period between the second and third votes was a critical time, or maybe it wasn't quite that long, but that was the major thrust. After the third vote, and we really dropped off our efforts. I don't think we picketed again until perhaps we knew the day of the vote was coming. It is hard for me today to realize that it was a 28-month battle that we waged. I think we won partly because some members did stay in, and there are people in this club who stayed despite our pleading with them and begging them to resign. There are members who stayed simply because they wanted to get this issue resolved and behind them. There were a hardcore, I'm just delighted so many are here today, of women, and I have to say we're a very respectable bunch in the main, but we came every week and picketed out in front. The parallel for me that is most striking is to look at the changes that were made in the Oregon statutes and the other societal changes that were going on during this 28-month period. Because many of us, Eleanor Davis was the chair of a group, and we went to the legislature, lobbied through the ratification of the Equal Rights Amendment. Oregon's, prior to the federal changes in the law, Oregon's equal credit law, a public accommodation law that allowed us to eat at Meyer and Frank Men's Grill, which we had also picketed, I might add, and Lippmann's Perkins Pub at the time did not allow women during the lunch hour. Both of those institutions, we were able to change the law and integrate the facility before the club made its decision to change. So you can get some sense of what a tremendous time and what a lot of energy was going on. A lot of women today, I think the hardest thing for me is realizing that many women today, one, don't believe it was only 15 years ago, but two, still shake their heads and wonder that it was really necessary. I suggest that there are still battles in employment discrimination. There are certain clubs that other members of this group are talking about. The Arlington Club, as we know, does not allow women members, and maybe our next step should be the Men's Grill at the University Club.
Thanks, Don, and And thanks, Gretchen, for telling us these stories. I'd like very much to acknowledge those in the audience who played a role in this. Seated at the tables near the front are some of the founding members of POW and some of the original signers of the 1970 petition to admit women. I'd just like to have all of you here to stand up so we can all recognize you and thank you for what you did. Some of those would like to make a comment or two about their experiences, and I believe that maybe Dr. Wright would like to say a few words, and I think Pauline Anderson maybe. So why don't you just do that, any of you that feel like it, the mic in the back, or if you feel like coming up, either way.
Mr. President, members of the City Club, friends, one does remember. And while it incites humor now, it would be a serious business then. In life's passages that must be negotiated by a boy growing into manhood, none is more precarious and dangerous seeming to him than the realization that he can abandon an exclusive male society and confidently enter into a society in which females are acknowledged. This takes some effort in growing up. But the City Club finally negotiated it and discovered that the masculinity would not be swamped in the flood of femininity that would come. But would discover in that new teamwork an incentive and richness and opportunity otherwise unavailable. The City Club established its adulthood, and that's what we're celebrating.
Pauline. We love you, Dr. Wright. Pauline Anderson, member of the club. I happen to know who it was that didn't want to compete with housewives for a seat at the table. Bless his piggy heart. I coerced him into sponsoring me for membership at the time I joined the club. As a new member of the club, I sat down at a kind of a sleepy table one Friday across from Cliff Carlson and trying to liven up the conversation at the table and at the same time showing my interest in civic affairs, I said across the table in a voice that could be heard all the way across the table to Cliff, I hear you got into a pissing match with Paul Meyer at City Hall today. At that point, it was no longer a sleepy table. And Cliff's... Thanks, Dan. I knew that... Cliff did say that I knew that our standards of decorum would die if we admitted women. Shortly thereafter, he nominated me to the Board of Governors. When Sid Lezak called and asked if I'd accept the nomination for first woman president of the club, and I accepted, he said, "You better be good." I meekly agreed that I better be good. And I knew that in order to be the first woman president and respectable, I had to be funny, articulate, warm, clever, non-threatening, tough, fair, gracious, sensitive, and it didn't hurt to be a little bit brave, clean, and reverent. And so I tried to be. When people asked if I wrote my own material, I didn't say, "Oh no, my husband writes it." I said, "Yes, I do. It's easy. I just sit down at a typewriter and open a vein." And with the weight of womankind and on my shoulders, that first woman president year was easy. I became anemic from opening veins. But it's a great club, and I was truly honored to be its first woman president.
Betty Roberts has a wonderful story. Where's Betty? There you are.
Well, I really hadn't intended to speak. I've just enjoyed so much sitting here listening to history helping me recall the history. But the story that I told Gretchen recently that I recall, and I tried to find the article that Doug Baker reported, and I had hoped that Don might have gone back in his, looking at his newspaper, might have found it. But I was sitting in my law office while all of this was going on, I guess in 71 or 72, up in the Boise Cascade building one day, and I had a telephone call from a gentleman who was a City Club member, and he said to me, Senator Roberts, identified himself and said, we have a committee at the City Club that is studying the election laws, and we wanted to, with the purpose in mind of introducing some legislation or recommending some legislation next session for some reforms in the election laws. And he said, we wondered if you would come and work with us on that committee. And I said, you want me to work with you on your committee at the City Club? And he said, yes, that's what I'm asking. And I said, I'm sorry, I can't help you if you can't make me a member. And he was quite flustered, and I had been a little too bold, I guess. And that was reported then in the next few days in Doug Baker's column, and that gave us another little boost that if they want us, make us equal.
George Casterline, where are you, George? There you are.
Honestly, I didn't ask to speak, but I'm pleased to. I'm a fairly old-fashioned guy, as witnessed by the fact that my necktie is probably older than most of the members. But it really didn't occur to me when I was presenting the original petition to the board of directors that it was anything unusual. I'm accustomed to being surrounded by competent women, and it was a surprise to me that this club didn't much earlier vote to get women into the club. It was, of course, the two-thirds majority that was the downfall, but I'm glad we finally made it.
We don't have time for any questions, but we have time for one more comment, and Charlie Davis usually gets the last word in. Where are you, Charlie? There he is.
Thank you. I think as we celebrate this occasion of coming to our adulthood 15 years ago, we should now give some thought to our responsibility in the rest of the community for other organizations that have not come to adulthood yet. And in that respect, I plan to prepare for the Board of Governors a resolution urging, as the American Bar Association has urged its members, urging our members to shun participation in other organizations in our community that discriminate in their membership practices against women and racial minorities. I think it is important for the club to make its influence known in that arena. I'm not suggesting that we take a position with respect to all clubs in the community, but certainly all of those that do or intend to have an influence on the economics and politics of our town. And in that respect, I certainly would include the Arlington Club as one of those that we ought, as a organization, addressed with some serious concern. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Charlie, and thanks to all of you for helping this club remain as the true conscience of our city. We are adjourned.